Hello friends, welcome back to the Brilliancy Point. Hope you all are doing very well in your studies. So today we are going to study another short story from class 12 Echoes, which is The Singing Lesson by Katherine Mansfield. As usual, we'll start with a very brief description about the author, and then I'll tell you a very detailed and in-depth explanation of this story. Let us start. I'll tell you just a few important points about the author. Katherine Mansfield was born on 14th October 1888 and died on 9th January 1923. So she died at a very early age of just 34 due to a pulmonary tuberculosis. And she is known to have revolutionized the 20th century English short story, how stories were written at that time. And her best work shakes itself free of plots and endings, means her most of the stories are open-ended and they provide a scope for the readers to think. And this was for the first time that the poets or the authors gave such a scope for the readers to think also about the interior life of the characters and of the authors, and the poetry of feeling and the blurred edges of personality. And Katherine Mansfield, her stories are taught worldwide because of her historical importance as well as because her prose offers lessons in entering ordinary lives that are still vivid and strong. Means we can, even today we can relate well with the stories that were written by her a century ago. Now this story, The Singing Lesson, it was published in 1922 and it displays the themes of despair, sadness, reliance, appearance, desperation and happiness. So this is quite an interesting story with a very wide range of emotions and a wide range of themes. So the very first paragraph, as you can see, is a straightforward description of how the protagonist of the story, whose name is Miss Meadows, so how Miss Meadows is feeling at that particular time. So with despair, cold sharp despair, buried deep in her heart like a wicked knife, Miss Meadows, in cap and gown and carrying a little baton, trod the cold corridors that led to the music hall. So Miss Meadows, she is a music teacher. And she is teaching in a particular school, and now something has very deeply hurted her. She is feeling very downhearted, very disheartened at this particular time, as it is mentioned, with cold, sharp despair, which is within her heart like a wicked knife. Now, wicked knife is an imagery used here, so as to express the strongness how much desperate she is feeling. So this is a comparison with a knife, that something is like hota hai na koi baat hame bahut chubh jati hai bheetar tak, to bahut zyada koi baat Miss Meadows ko chubh gayi hai, and she is carrying a little baton with her and she is heading towards the music hall. Girls of all ages, rosy from the air and bubbling over with that gleeful excitement that comes from running to the school on a fine autumn morning, hurried, skipped. The hollow classrooms came a quick drumming of voices, a bell rang, a voice like bird came, Muriel. So this is all the description of the surrounding of Miss Meadows, that it was a fine autumn morning, means this is a winter season going on and there is coldness all around. Right, and what usually happens in a school, a bell ringing, then a quick drumming of voices coming and all. So this is a usual school atmosphere accompanied by the coldness of the winter season. So an important point to note here is that there is a similarity between Miss Meadows and her surroundings. That similarity is the coldness, as we can see in the first line, with despair, cold, sharp despair. So when we talk about hopelessness, despair and unhappiness, so we say that these are all cold feelings, means if one is not feeling happy and energetic and all, lack of enthusiasm, then वी कैन से द हार्ट इज वेरी कोल्ड. सो द कोल्डनेस ऑफ मिस मेडोज हार्ट इज एक्चुअली इनडायरेक्टली एंड इन अ वेरी फेंट मैनर इट इज कंपेयर्ड विद द कोल्डनेस अराउंड हर. मीन्स द कोल्डनेस ऑफ द विंटर सीजन इज बींग कंपेयर्ड विद द कोल्डनेस ऑफ मिस मेडोज हार्ट. बट अगेन दीज टू कोल्डनेस आर क्वाइट डिफरेंट. एज वी कैन सी द कोल्डनेस ऑफ द विंटर सीजन इट इज इन अ वे इट इज अ काइंड ऑफ एक्साइटमेंट. इट इज द ब्यूटी ऑफ द विंटर सीजन. एज वी कैन सी द डिस्क्रिप्शन हियर गर्ल्स ऑफ ऑल एजेस रोजी फ्रॉम द एयर एंड बबलिंग ओवर विद दैट ग्लीफुल एक्साइटमेंट. सो द कोल्डनेस ऑफ द एटमोसफेयर इज समवेयर पॉजिटिव वेयर एज द कोल्डनेस ऑफ मिस मेडोज हार्ट इज कंप्लीटली नेगेटिव बिकॉज शी इज फीलिंग वेरी डेस्परेट. Now, as she was heading towards the music hall, she comes across Science Mistress and they both have a conversation. So, the conversation is quite normal as we have in our day-to-day life. But an important point to note here is that, see, how the Science Mistress and her words are addressed. Good morning, she cried in a sweet, affected drawl. Okay. And drawl, if we talk about, then drawl is something like drawl means something that we put on. So it is a kind of artificiality. So artificiality of science mistress is being highlighted here that she might be a woman who is not very natural in her behavior. She is a kind of showing off and boasting and that kind of a person. And again, when we see here, Miss Meadows hugging the knife stared and hated at the science mistress. So Miss Meadows did not like science mistress for her affected role, means for her unnatural behavior. And everything about her was sweet, pale, like honey. You would have not been surprised to see a bee caught in the tangles of that yellow hair. So again, this is a kind of a metaphor which is being used to a kind of describe science mistress that she talked very sweet and pale like honey. Means बोलता ना कि कोई बहुत मीठा बोलता है अपने मुंह मियाँ मिट्टू बनना. मीन्स वॉट एवर शी स्पोक शी डिड नॉट फेल्ट इट. सो दिस डिस्क्रिप्शन ऑफ साइंस मिस्ट्रेस इज एक्चुअली pointing towards a very important theme in the story, which we will discover later on in the story. The theme is appearance versus reality and illusion versus reality. We can see that how people are affected by appearance and how appearance plays an important role in our life. So this description of science mistress is actually, it may be deliberately made by the author in order to give a hint towards the theme of the story, that is appearance versus illusion. So again, Miss Meadows says it is rather sharp, and then the science mistress says, "You look frozen." Means somewhere the science mistress might have noticed the feelings or the change in behavior of Miss Meadows, as we see that the how Miss Meadows was feeling. Her feelings were very strong. She was feeling very strongly desperate and she was completely hopeless at that particular moment. So there might be a little change in her behavior, which science mistress has noticed. So then, after having conversed with science mistress, Miss Meadows passes on towards the music hall, where classes 4, 5, and 6 they were assembled, and the noise was deafening. Means those students, they might be singing a song in a very loud voice, in a very loud tone. And there stood Mary Beasley, who was Miss Meadows' favorite student. And as soon as she saw Miss Meadows coming towards the music hall, she said, "Shh, girls, Miss Meadows is coming." She warned the other students. Now, Miss Meadows, her hands thrust in her sleeves, the baton under her arm, strode down the center aisle, mounted the steps, turned sharply, seized the brass music stand, planted it in front of her and gave two sharp taps with her baton for silence. So Miss Meadows now entered the class and she made some arrangements for her and then she tapped her baton twice in order to silent the class. And she said, Silence, please, immediately. And now her glance swept over that sea of colored flannel blouses with bobbling pink faces and hands, quivering butterfly hair bows and music books outspread. So this is the description of the students. Now a sea of colored flannel blouses means all the students who are in their uniform and with their sweet and cute faces, bobbling pink faces and hair accessories. And in front of all of them, there was a music book opened. She knew perfectly well what they might be thinking. Mandy is in a wax. This line is an indication towards the changed behavior or the transformed behavior of Miss Meadows. That today Miss Meadows was somewhere, she was acting, she was behaving in a different way as usual. Right? She was quite more strict than usual than she ever had, because her mood is not, she is not in a good mood, that's why. So students might be thinking that, oh, today maybe he's in a wax, means she is not in a good mood. Well, let them think it. Her eyelids quivered, she tossed her head, deafening them. What could the thoughts of those creatures matter to someone who stood there bleeding to death, pierced to the heart by such a letter? So these lines are a direct indication towards the strong feelings of Miss Meadows, that she was bleeding to death, pierced to the heart, means she was very, very deeply moved by a letter. Now what was the letter? Let's see. I feel more and more strongly that our marriage would be a mistake. Not that I do not love you. I love you as much as it is possible for me to love any woman. But truth to tell, I have come to the conclusion that I am not a marrying man, and the idea of settling down fills me with nothing but the word disgust was written over there, and then the word disgust, it was scratched, and on the top of it the word regret was written. So this is the reason why Miss Meadows was feeling so disheartened, so downhearted that day. It was this letter from her fiance Basil breaking off their marriage. And that, coming back to the present condition, Miss Meadows has already entered the class, and Mary Beasley, who was her favorite student, she was waiting for her to greet her. So she bent forward and she greeted her, "Good morning, Miss Meadows." And then she also handed a very beautiful flower, yellow chrysanthemum, to Miss Meadows. And this is not something new for either of them, for Miss Meadows or for Mary Beasley. This had been a ritual in that, probably in that particular school, that before starting the music lesson, every day Mary Beasley hands over a flower, a yellow chrysanthemum, to Miss Meadows. And every day how Miss Meadows reacts to this? Miss Meadows says thank you to Mary Beasley, means she takes it very happily, with pleasure, and she says thank you to Mary Beasley, and she also tucks that flower into her hair. But today, as she was already in a very bad mood, she totally ignored the chrysanthemum and made no reply to Mary Beasley's greeting. She did not reply to her greeting also, okay? And she straight away, in a voice of ice, means without any feeling, okay, very strongly, very straightforwardly, without any feeling, at once she said, "Page 14, please, and mark all accents well." And this was obviously a very staggering moment for Mary Beasley. Okay, and she felt so, like, she felt a kind of dejected. So she felt very bad, and tears also came into her eyes. But Miss Meadows ignored her tears as well. Okay, and she again said, "Page 14, we'll begin with page 14, a lament." Means today she is asking the students to sing a lament. And why a lament? It is quite evident because of her mood. Because a lament suits her mood. Okay, so this also is actually highlighting that how moved she is and how engrossed she is. Means she is physically present in the class, but mentally she is still engrossed with that letter. She is still disappointed. She is still in that feeling, being disheartened and being disappointed by the letter. And that is why she is asking the students to sing a lament. वी शैल टेक इट ऑल टुगेदर, नॉट इन पार्ट्स, ऑल टुगेदर एंड विदाउट एनी एक्सप्रेशन. शी रेज द बेटन, शी टैप द म्यूजिक स्टैंड ट्वाइस, डाउन केम मैरी ऑन द ओपनिंग कॉर्ड, डाउन केम ऑल दोज लेफ्ट हैंड्स बीटिंग द एयर एंड इन चाइंड दोज यंग मोनफुल वॉइसेस. ओके, सो दिस इज द लेमन. Fast are too fast, fade the roses of pleasure. Soon autumn yields unto winter drear. Fleetly are fleetly, music's gay measure passes away from the listening ear. So, this lament is quite a suitable one, means which suits her feeling as well as the season or the atmosphere. So, the first line says that the roses of pleasure means the pleasure, the beautiful things, okay, the happiness and the good things, they have faded. So very fast the roses of pleasure means all the good things have ended and autumn yields into winter drear. So drear is a negative word, okay. Drear means the harshness of winter and the death kind of a thing. So now autumn is so harsh as it is kind of, it is killing. And then fleetly or fleetly, music's gay measure passes away from the listening ear. This means that how very soon this music also passes away from the listening ear. And how very silently, which is somewhere pointing towards the fact that every good thing, every happiness is a very momentary thing, is a very momentary feeling, and it ends in a very short period of time in a jiffy. So this is the lament that Miss Meadows is asking the students to sing without any expression. Good heavens, what could be more tragic than that lament? Every note was a sigh, a sob, a groan of awful mournfulness. Miss Meadows lifted her arms in the white gown and began conducting with both hands. I feel more and more strongly that our marriage would be a mistake. So what is happening that Miss Meadows is still engrossed with that letter, and she is asking the students to sing a lament. And while she is hearing that lament, she is again and again recalling the words and the lines that her fiance Basil had written in the letter. Means she is a kind of feeling very sorrowful continuously. Now what could have possessed him to write such a letter? What could have led up to it? It came out of nothing. His last letter had been all about a fumed oak bookcase he had bought for our books, and a natty little hall stand he had seen, a very neat affair with a carved owl on a bracket holding three head thrushes in its claws. How she had smiled at that. So like a man to think one needed three head thrushes. From the listening ear sang the voices. So now Miss Meadows is also recalling the past events, the past, her past meetings with Basil. And she remembers that what was the last letter. Like this letter actually came suddenly without any specific reason. Okay, it came out of nothing. Means even it is hard for Miss Meadows to believe that why is Basil writing such a letter. Because what was his last letter? In his last letter, he was like talking about their house, that after marriage, he was talking about, like he was saying that he has seen a bookcase for their books. And he was like talking about decorating their home and all. Like he was talking about the togetherness, that they both are together. Now suddenly he is writing a letter to break off the marriage, that he is not a marrying man. So it is kind of hard for Miss Meadows to believe that Basil is writing such a letter. Once again, said Miss Meadows, but this time in parts, still without expression. Now Miss Meadows gave instruction to the students that this time we have to sing in parts, but again without expression. So now she is recalling her last meeting with Basil. हमारे साथ भी ऐसा होता है ना कि जब अगर किसी के साथ हमारा जो रिलेशन है अगर वो एंड हो जाता है या फिर खराब हो जाता है किसी, सो हमें कैसी अच्छी बातें याद आती है उस रिलेशन की, हमें पुरानी अच्छी बातें याद आती है कि यार पहले तो कितना अच्छा था, ऐसा होता था, एक बार तो ऐसा हुआ था, मतलब हम अच्छी बातें याद करते हैं. तो वैसे ही Miss Meadows here, she is recalling good things about the past, good moments that she had spent with Basil. That last time when he had come to see her, He had worn a blue suit and he was looking very handsome in that. Okay, and then here is a conversation what they talked that time. So बेसिल इज टेलिंग दैट जहाँ पे बेसिल काम करता है वहाँ पे जो मालिक है उनकी जो वाइफ है शी अगेन एंड अगेन कीप्स ऑन आस्किंग हिम फॉर डिनर. सो नाउ ऑब्वियसली व्हेन ही इज सेइंग सच अ थिंग तो मिस मेडोज विल डेफिनेटली फील अ काइंड ऑफ ऑफेंडेड और शी विल फील अ काइंड ऑफ जेलस. ओके सो शी इज आस्किंग दैट बट कांट यू रिफ्यूज. So he says, "Oh well, it doesn't do for a man in my position to be unpopular. It is a kind of boasting, also we can say, and it is also an underlining or an indication towards the fact that Basil, as well as Miss Meadows, both of them were quite appearance-oriented. We saw above that Miss Meadows is saying that Basil was handsome. So Basil was a very good-looking person. So he." Basil himself was also quite proud about his looks, and even Miss Meadows was very proud for Basil's look. So they both are a kind of appearance oriented. This fact is being highlighted through this conversation. So again, the students they were continuously singing that lament again and again without expression, and Miss Meadows was again and again recalling. The letter of the Basil and also the past meeting and the past moments she had spent with Basil. So again, Miss Meadows says, quite good, but still in such a strange, stony tone that the younger girls began to feel positively frightened. So Miss Meadows, obviously her mood is completely desperate and a kind of agony also, a kind of anger also is there inside her. That why has Basil written such a letter? So she is talking in a very harsh tone to the students. And now Miss Meadows says, now that we know it, we shall take it with expression. Now she is asking the students to add expression to the lament. When they are singing the lament, to add expressions as well. As much expression as you can put into it. Think of the words, girls. Use your imaginations. Fast are too fast, cried Miss Meadows. That ought to break out a loud, strong forte, a lament. And then in the second line, winter drear, make that drear sound if a cold wind were blowing through it. Drear, she said so awfully that Mary Beasley on the music stool wriggled her spine. The third line should be one crescendo, fleetly, ah, fleetly, music's gay measure, breaking on the first word of the last line. So now Miss Meadows is completely giving a very straightforward and a lot of instructions that how exactly she wants that lament to be sung. Now why is Miss Meadows acting so harsh and in a so we can say in that awful manner? Because the incident that has happened with her, it has completely broken her heart and it has awakened a lot of feelings inside Miss Meadows regarding why has the Basil written this letter. और अब एक इम्पॉर्टेंट बात यहाँ पे ये है कि म्यूजिक का हमारे लाइफ के साथ क्या कनेक्शन है, म्यूजिक का हमारे इमोशंस, ठीक है, हमारी जो फीलिंग्स है उससे क्या कनेक्शन है. मतलब जब भी हम खुश होते हैं तो हमें अच्छा गाना सुनने का मन करता है ना. ऐसा तो नहीं होता कि अगर हम बहुत खुश है तो हम एक सैड सॉन्ग सुनेंगे. नो, इट नेवर हैपन्स. जब हम खुश होते हैं तो हमें लगता है कि हमको ये बहुत एक मैरी मेकिंग और एक बहुत ही चीयरफुल सा सॉन्ग सुने. एंड एट द सेम टाइम व्हेन वी आर अ लिटिल सैड तो हमें लगता है कि हमको एक अच्छा सा सैड सॉन्ग सुने, ठीक है. और उसमें भी ना जो इंसिडेंट हमारे साथ होता है ना, वी वॉन्ट टू लिसन टू अ सॉन्ग रिलेटेड टू दैट इंसिडेंट. ओके, ऐसा होता है. तो यहाँ पे वही बात है कि मिस मेडोज क्या चाहती है. मिस मेडोज वॉन्ट्स दैट लैमेंट शुड सपोर्ट हर फीलिंग्स. ओके, शी वॉन्ट्स दैट द स्टूडेंट्स शुड सिंग दैट लैमेंट इन सच अ वे विद अ होल लॉट ऑफ एक्सप्रेशन एंड सो स्ट्रॉन्गली एज शी इज फीलिंग. सो शी वॉन्ट्स हर फीलिंग्स टू बी कम्प्लीटली कम्प्लीटली स्प्रेड ऑफ दैट लैमेंट. सो शी वॉन्ट्स दैट एंड इट इज क्वाइट नेचुरल ऑल्सो. Again the two light taps, she lifted her arms again, fast are too fast, and the idea of settling down fills me with nothing but disgust. Disgust was what he had written. that was as good as to say their engagement was definitely broken off. Broken off their engagement. People had been surprised enough that she had got engaged. The science mistress would not believe it at first, but nobody had been as surprised as she. So again, Miss Meadows gave two light taps on the music stand, and the students, they were singing, and the students, they kept on singing the lament again and again, and with full expression. And Miss Meadows was engrossed with the letter. Please mark this, disgust was what he had written. Now if we look at the two words, disgust and regret, then both of them are negative words, first of all. And secondly, what we might feel, if we look at these two words in normal sense, we would feel that these two words are not very different from each other, okay? They, more or less, they convey the same meaning. Both are negative and both are a kind of a no, saying a no. But disgust is a very strong expression. It is, you know, it is more negative, it is more strong expression. Like when do we use the word disgust? We use it when someone is annoying us, when we are angry at someone, okay? When someone is troubling us again and again. जब अपन बहुत ज़्यादा परेशान हो जाते हैं किसी चीज़ से कि यार अब नहीं हो सकता. That is disgust. And regret, in front of disgust, so relatively regret is a lighter word, which just conveys that if we are not taking a very a completely appropriate action, then we may regret. So that is what Miss Meadows is feeling, that why has Basil used such a word? Why is he feeling so disgusted about this? And definitely this letter meant that their marriage, their engagement has been broken off. Now people had been surprised enough that she had got engaged. Now why were people surprised? If we see usually, so engagement is a matter of happiness, right? People get happy if someone is engaged. But people were surprised, and she herself was surprised. Now, what was the reason? The first reason is she was 30 and Basil was 25. Means Basil was younger to Miss Meadows. Okay, so this disparity between a girl and a boy, and that too, the boy is younger than the girl. This is something that our society earlier did not accept. If we talk about present generation, then this thing happens very openly, that a younger boy is marrying an elder girl. Okay, this is a very common thing these days. But if we talk about the time period when this story was written, it was published in 1922, means it was written even before that, around 1916 or 17. So at that period of time, it was not permitted, and actually it did not used to happen that a younger boy is marrying an elder girl. And secondly, there was a very orthodox, a very, you know, specific mindset about the women in the society, that girls were expected to get married max to max by the age of 25. Means Miss Meadows' own age is also a very important factor for which society might be looking down upon her. You know, she's again and again thinking about how society would react to her marriage being broken off. She's again and again thinking how science mistress would react, how people would react. So why is she's in a pressure about the society, that what society would think? The reason is that because 30 at that particular time when the story was written, 30 was very late for a woman to be married. And if a woman was not married till the age of 30, people used to think that this lady is not appropriate. I mean, she is not a normal person. She might be disabled, or she might not have good looks, or she is not able to find a suitable groom for her. Means there is some defect in the girl because of which she is unable to find a groom for her. That's why she is thinking that people were actually surprised to know that she is engaged at the age of 30. And now if her engagement is broken, then obviously people would laugh at her, people will make fun of her, people will mock her. And if we look at the setting of the story, then somewhere it is evident also that Miss Meadows is going through the torments of the society. She is going through the societal pressure. Because she's again and again thinking about how society would react if her marriage is broken off, if she's afraid of it. So why is she feeling like that? Because probably people are looking down upon her. Matlab, people are treating her as inferior somewhere, that she's not still married. So a kind of she has lost social respect, a dignity in the society. And if this engagement is broken off, her respect, her dignity in the society, it will go even down. So with this, we come to an end of the first part of the story. Now the climax of the story, the end, and also the importance of the title of the story, all these things we will discuss in the second part. So till then, bye, take care and study well.